Join us in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Let the record show that all council members are present this evening, except our mayor, and we hope he's having fun. He should be back with us in a few days. We'd like to start the meeting with, we have a copy of the Open Meetings Act that's posted on the west wall, and it is accessible to any members of the public anytime during the course of the meeting you'd like to address it. We'd like now to, we have one proclamation. We'd like to proclaim April 23rd through the 29th, 2017, as National Volunteer Week. Okay. Whereas volunteers in Beatrice mentor our children, feed our hungry, comfort our lonely, beautify our green spaces, and fundraise for our charitable organizations. And whereas volunteers are young, old, families, workers, retirees, men and women of all ages and backgrounds. And whereas countless citizens enhance the quality of life of others by volunteering with service organizations in schools, places of worship, hospitals, youth groups, and with other organizations that benefit our community. And whereas National Volunteer Week is more than 40-year tradition enacted in 1974 by President Nixon that designates a special time to recognize and celebrate the contributions of volunteers. Now, I Stan Worth, Mayor of the City of Beatrice, do hereby proclaim April 23rd through the 29th, 2017, as National Volunteer Week. Say thank you for the countless hours volunteers donate to improve our community, and urge my fellow citizens to recognize the crucial role played by volunteers in our community. Witness my hand and the official seal of the City of Beatrice this, the 17th day of April 27th. Do we have anybody in the audience?
Nope, we don't. Okay.
Tobias will take care of that. Thank you. All righty. We will begin with our consent agenda. All items under the consent agenda are considered to be routine by the City Council and will be enacted by one motion. There will be no separate discussion of these items unless a council member or citizen so requests. Item A, approve agenda as submitted. Item B, receive and place on file all notices pertaining to this meeting. Item C, receive and place on file all materials having any bearing on this meeting. Approval of minutes of regular meeting on April 3rd, 2017, as on file in the City Clerk's office. Item E, approval of Treasurer's Report of Claims. E1, approval of Beatrice Humane Society claim in the amount of $5,000. Item E2, approval of Gauge Area Growth Engage claim in the amount of $36,920.50. Item E3, approval of balance of Treasurer's Report of Claims in the amount of $228,421.07. Item F, approval of BASWA Report of Claims in the amount of $89,599.92. Item G, approval of write-off of ambulance bed debts. Item H, award a bid for the 2nd Street Reconstruction Project, Ella to Grant 2017 project to Lottman Carpenter Construction in the amount of $541,504.15, as recommended by the Board of Public Works. Item I, approval of public funding request from Community Possibilities in the amount of $400 for the Beatrice Third Thursday's events. Item J, approval of public funding request from Friends of the Homestead in the amount of $5,000 for the Solar Eclipse Weekend Transportation System. Item K, approval of Beatrice Plus funding request from St. Joe's Catholic School in the amount of $1,000 for the installation of an ADA-compliant concrete path into the playground. Item L, approval of Beatrice Plus funding request from Main Street Beatrice in the amount of $2,250 for downtown trash receptacles and a bench. Item M, approval of Beatrice Plus funding request from Friends of the Homestead in the amount of $5,000 for bus transportation during the eclipse weekend. Item N, resolution number 6045, appointing Jana Robertson to the Beatrice Planning and Zoning Commission. Item O, resolution number 6046, executing the agreement between the City of Beatrice and Nebraska Department of Roads regarding improvements to Highway US 77 as recommended by the Board of Public Works. Do we have anybody on the council that would like an item removed? Ted?
I have two. Item K is in King and M is in Mary.
K and M.
Petey.
Ted, Richie.
Item L.
Okay. And Bob.
I will abstain from E2. And just a point of clarification, is the transportation of J and M two separate items or a repeat?
Two separate items. One's out of Beatrice Plus funds, one's out of the funding policy. Okay. Two different funding sources.
All right. Thank you.
Petey.
So noted, Bob.
I need to abstain on E1.
And Sparkio abstain from item E1. All righty. Is anybody else on the council?
Yes, sir.
Go ahead.
J, please.
J?
And you thought it was going to be easy, David.
Yeah. Anybody from the audience like something removed? There's not much left, but. All righty. Seeing none. Dwight, I would entertain a motion.
I make a motion that items listed under consent agenda, with the exception of items J, K, L, M, be approved, accepted, ratified as presented.
Second.
Who seconded that?
Rick.
Richie. Okay. All righty. Moving back to item. Oh, we need a vote, please. And that carries 8-0. All righty. 7-0.
No, he can vote, counts.
He votes.
I can vote.
He can vote?
Yep. I can vote.
He can vote.
He can vote.
He can vote.
You vote.
Is that a kid's? All righty. Moving back to item J. Dwight, please.
I make a motion that approval of public funding request from Friends of the Homestead in the amount of $5,000 for the solar eclipse weekend transportation system be approved, accepted, and ratified as presented.
Second.
Motion by party, second by Cookie. And discussion.
Well, I pulled it off because I was just kind of, well, I see we have two of them on here, so they both might be a little bit different. I just don't know if we need to fund things that are outside the city. Another question that I have probably for Mark is we have $10,000 supposedly going towards this. Is there anything in there that says if there's rain in the forecast, or rain happens, that we don't have to pay all this money?
Mark, would you come forward, please? And
it's still going to be dark.
And just for the record, please state your name, please.
Mark Engler, Superintendent, Homestead National Monument.
Diane Vickers, President of the Friends of Homestead.
All right. Please sit down.
You don't have to stand.
No, there is nothing. I guess right now where we are with the putting together the package is that we're out for bid right now, but there is no provision in there in the event of bad weather.
Was that discussed previously with anybody? I mean, or is that something you could put in there just to save half price, three-quarter price if the sun don't shine?
We can go back in and discuss that and see if our contracting people allow us to put that in there. We can we can ask that question.
I just see if not, we're going to be paying a lot for buses to be sitting empty, and I'm not sure what they'll bring out to your people, very many of anyway.
We can ask that question.
Okay, thank you.
Now, a point of clarification, you're going to, these buses can be used wherever the highest impact of travelers would be, not only out to the Homestead National Monument, but you, in our packet here, it says that they would be going different places in town also, correct?
Correct. First of all, I guess if I could just back up and thank the Friends of Homestead for submitting the request on our behalf. We have within the package are 3 days of for a transportation system to help handle what we're expecting to be a huge crowd within the community and then coming to the monument. And each of those 3 days, we plan to operate buses around the monument. And then each of those 3 days, we plan to come into the community. We've had the preliminary discussions with Michael with Main Street and have asked them their interest in having us come down and make a pickup within the downtown area. And as well, we've also been talking with the folks at the Gage County Fairgrounds and running the bus service there. That's on Saturday, Sunday. And then on Monday, we would up the game from the standpoint of running buses, where I mentioned before, plus then the one would constantly be circling the community from the standpoint of using Hickory Road, coming on to 77, making stops at the hotels, making stops, a stop at the airport, coming into downtown, picking up whoever needs a ride from downtown, and then going to the fairgrounds, to the monument. And yes, we are putting in a structure or a system that will allow us to be flexible from the standpoint if we see we have more people to be picked up in one area, we will divert those buses to those areas as well. We are also writing into the specifications that if we see the need for additional buses or additional times, we will have a contract price on what that'll cost to extend the hours of operation.
Well, I hope
but
you.
We're I guess just to explain, we're going to be putting in to operate the band, operate the transportation system. We'll basically have staff assigned to that as well. We'll have volunteers helping us and manage that. We'll be placing an incident command person in the overall community's command system. As well, we'll have a commander on site that'll help us manage the incident. That's what we're referring to, the 3 days. In fact, on Saturday morning, we'll be going into a 24-hour operational period. We will be opening our facilities daily from 8:30 in the morning till 10 in the evening, both Saturday and Sunday. Monday morning, the day of the eclipse, we'll be opening our facilities at 6 a.m. And through the night, we'll be going in, we'll have staff on site because we've just received many calls from people wanting to have 24-hour access to the monument. And so we are going to grant that. And we're going to, along with that, have staff on site. To give you all a little better idea of the complexity and everything that's going on, I have just a schedule.
We're just discussing the bus.
Okay.
Buses, Mark.
Okay. I was going to say I'd be happy to
Tobias, where's the money coming from?
For
this item. Item K.
This one, item K. Or excuse me, item J.
J, I'm sorry.
Coming from the funding policy. So this is the line item we put in the budget about 4 or 5 years ago. We put $15,000 in there. As your memo and your packet indicated, if you award both of these, you will overspend that line item by about $2,000 this year. We'll simply amend the budget at the end of the year like we always do, and then that funding line item will be done going forward this year.
Yeah, and it kind of bleeds into what I pulled off on, excuse me, on item M, but I think and that's what I gathered from this, kind of asking a question I need the answer to, but I think the revenue that we get from the hotel tax revenue, that's part of this money, and I think that's the appropriate revenue source for this. Do we gather more than $15,000 in that fund from that?
In the lodging tax fund?
Yeah.
Yes.
Well, that's where I would be more inclined to get the money from. I think when we talked about the lodging tax, when we passed it here, that as a body, these are the types of things that we actually had in mind for that. So I'm not opposed to either one of the funding, either one of the amounts. I'm opposed to the funding mechanism on item M, and get to that. But I think this on item J, I don't have a problem with this. I think that's where what we should, that's how we should be funding it. So as long as that's where the revenue's from. My only problem that I have with any of this as far as the busing goes is I think you ought to charge something, $1. $1 every time somebody steps on one of your shuttles. I think it would offset your cost. I mean, if you're honestly thinking that you're going to get, I don't remember what it said in the packet, somewhere between 10, your system could transport to 10,000 to 12,000 people on the 3-day weekend. A buck a crack, you've got this paid for. So I've rarely rode a shuttle anywhere that they didn't charge me something. So I'm only putting that as a suggestion anyway. I'm voting for item J. I just need some clarifications. So
I think something to keep in mind that was in some of the discussions I've had with people, and because that came up, was that I guess it's more out of a courtesy thing for us not to charge the people for use of the bus, because we want to encourage them to use the bus to help alleviate some of the troubles with the parking and getting people from. It keeps them out of the downtown. It gets them in the downtown, but it keeps the vehicles out of the downtown. So if they have a spot at the campsites or something where they can get that bus coming through, pick them up, it was more of a courtesy thing. So I think if we're going to fund the money to do it, just my opinion, I would say that we don't need to really charge them, because they're going to be spending their dollars in Beatrice. I'd much rather see it as a courtesy thing and a way to really encourage them to use it.
Richie. This $10,000 that you're asking for, that's going to cover the entire cost of the busing. Are you putting any money in it?
No. Yes. There's 25% breakdown over four different groups. Over both of the counts that we've been discussing here, plus the Friends of Homestead will be putting forth money, and then Homestead donation accounts will be putting in funds towards it as well. So it's a 425% pies.
If we
we'll be working from
Greg, this is a question for you. If we fund this, mm-hmm. and our name's on that, and a shuttle bus happens to be in an accident, what's our liability on this?
I would say nearly next to nothing, other than we're using some coordination, because the contract for that is going to be. Through Friends of Homestead. They're the ones that are going to have to be insured along with the contractor they use. We're always going to have ourselves out there, because they're going to be going on. If they pick people up in parks, in public places that are controlled by the city, there's always the question of liability. In regards to the funding, I don't know that we'll have any specific for that reason.
I can share with you that there is a clause within the contract that addresses that.
Okay.
Alrighty, any more discussion? Oh, I'm sorry.
So is there a way we can change the funding then to the lodging tax?
You have to remember, the lodging tax goes into your general fund dollars. There's no special pool where the lodging tax goes. This money comes out of your general fund dollars. We at the administration simply decide if it's best if it comes out of Keno or lodging tax or some other thing that year, all of it goes into your general fund dollars. So the short answer is
yes, no.
But no. Not really. I mean, it's all lodging tax,
yes,
it's all general
no.
fund.
Okay, any further discussion? Any further questions?
Hope you fill all the buses every day.
Don't you think you ought to wait to see if it's passed first?
It's my hope. This is a hope.
Alrighty. No further discussion. Let's see our vote, please. And that passes with an 8-0 vote. Alrighty. Moving on to item K, Mr. Party.
I'll make a motion to approval of the Beatrice Plus funding request for the St. Joseph Catholic School amount in the amount of $1,000 for the installation of an ADA-compliant concrete path into playground be approved, accepted, ratified as presented.
Second.
Righty.
I pulled it off.
Teddy, it's yours.
I think it's a great, I have to vote against this. I pulled it off because I have to vote against it. I think it's a great project. I think that in a different locale, in a different instance, this would be appropriate. You look at it, the city's master plan, we have all our neighborhood elementary schools listed as parks. This is not listed as a park in our master plan. I think this enters into a kind of a slippery slope. We have numerous churches that in the community that have capital campaigns for different things, and I think that it's going to be hard to turn them down. I mean, we have two churches that are getting ready to build structures. I think it'll be hard to turn them down. I think it's a good, I think it's a good project, but this isn't in the city's wheelhouse. We shouldn't be funding this. This is a, you know, the churches, it sits on private property. It's not open to the public. This playground is fenced in.
It is open. That was one of the first questions asked at the Beatrice Plus meeting was, is this open to the public? Uh-huh. And the principal of the school there indicated that, yes, in fact, it is open to the public. They'll be erecting a sign that clearly indicates it's open to the public on non-school hours. So anybody's welcome there. They'll be allowed to come in and play at that facility.
Yeah, I get you. I think it's a good project. This isn't something I'm comfortable with expending city funds for a specific religious organization. So I have to vote against it. So.
Ready? Anybody else? Bob.
And I guess that was my question too. I guess in some respects, anything that we do sets a precedent.
Yeah.
And so I'm concerned about what precedent we set and how do we then tell somebody else no and somebody else yes. And I guess with Ted, I'm a little bit concerned about that because it's one of those things that you get because you could have somebody also who built a playground and how do we determine even if they're going to have it open for the public because it's a great project. I agree. I just don't know how you say yes to one and then all of a sudden say no to another. I just don't know how you do that if you set this precedent. So I'm afraid I'm going to have to be a little bit like Ted on this and vote no.
Well, I would go back and show you that one of the first playgrounds that you built with Beatrice Plus funds was the playground that's in the mall. That's a playground on private property.
Voted against that too.
Well, at least you're consistent. But there again is a playground that was on private property that was built with Beatrice Plus funds. Back in the day. Now, Kate, you always have that line, yes, I mean, other people are going to build parks or playground structures, and how do you kind of handle those? To me, I think the important one, when Beatrice Plus looked at this, was, is this open to the public or is it not? And that was one of the key things they looked at. It's a
Christian. Thank you.
Was there any discussion about this in the Beatrice Plus meeting or the Board of Public Works meeting or anything? Did they have any, was there any other discussion?
Board of Public Works, no. Beatrice Plus, yes. You know, first the church came in and made their presentation, exactly what they're trying to do there. Then there was some discussion. Like I said, most of it centered around, is it open to the public? Is it not open to the public? And the school made it very clear that it was, and they would be erecting a sign that clearly states that this would be open to the public. And if you read through the Beatrice Plus minutes, which are in your packet, that was the way the motion was written, was it's contingent upon them putting up a sign that clearly states it's open to the public during non-school hours. So that was very important for the board there.
Yeah, I'll donate to it, but I can't vote for it. And I'm not a member of the church, so. That's all I had, David.
Okay, anybody else? Alrighty, I will entertain a vote, please.
Now what do you do?
Can I vote twice?
So you got Morgan and Claybaugh who voted no, and you've got Party and Fairbanks who voted no.
Okay.
Well, so it'll fail for a lack of votes.
All righty. Well, we'll move on then to item M, Mr. Party.
L?
L.
Make
a motion approval of Beatrice Plus Funds request for Main Street Beatrice in the amount of $2,250 for the downtown trash receptacles and a bench. For approved, be accepted, ratified as presented.
Second.
Moved by Hardy, second by Kerr. For the park bench and receptacles, Mr. Kerr, you pulled that off?
I did.
Okay.
Just wanted some clarification. 2 weeks ago, out of we gave money for this 2 weeks ago, $1,125, mm-hmm. Correct?
Correct.
It was out of public funding, correct?
That's correct.
This one is out of
Beatrice Plus.
Beatrice Plus. I went back and I pulled City of Beatrice public funding application from 2 weeks ago. Says here, downtown street furnishing, including benches and trash receptacles. You go down just a little bit further, it says funding costs. The city will pay only, fund up to only 25% of the total cost of any event or item. Funds requested by the city, $1,125. Funds from other sources, not the city, $3,375 for a total of $4,500. 2 weeks later, they come back asking for $2,250. What's the deal? It states right here on the application, not the city funding. They come back and they ask for more city funding, twice what they asked for last week, or 2 weeks ago. I stated I was going to keep a closer eye on this. Now that leaves them $1,125 left to pay for the $4,500. 2 weeks from now, are we going to have them back asking for $1,125 out of another fund? I would rather them come up and say, we need $4,500 for this project, instead of playing the games of one here, one here, and one here.
Well, the reason they came on two different agendas is because when the Beatrice Plus meeting fell. Beatrice Plus meeting fell after our last meeting, so that's why they didn't both occur on the last agenda. That's why they're there.
We okayed one that said, request for City of Beatrice funding. The funds, the second one, funds from other sources, not the city. States it right there.
They're two different funding policies, once again. That's where the money comes from.
But it's coming from the city, correct?
Both funds do come from the city. The other thing you have to keep in mind is once these items are purchased, they will be owned by the City of Beatrice.
It's the game. It's the game that's being played. If he wants it, $4,500. Guys, I want the $4,500. Fine, but it's the game they're playing.
Then you have the opportunity to change the rules on the funding policy to state that if you apply for this, you cannot apply for Beatrice Plus.
It already states it. It says right there, funds from other sources, not the city. This is your guys' application.
Yes, it is.
What this does,
not the city. He's asking for more city funds.
The nice part about what they're doing, Richie, at least they're coming forward at the different times, and they're giving us that opportunity if you want to discuss something like that. If you come in and say, well, I need $4,500 for this or $5,000 for that, a lot of times, I appreciate Michael and those guys breaking it down so we at least have an idea. We can tell you every penny of where it's going and to which project it's going. That's what they're... Go ahead, Mike.
Well, and one thing, we did talk about it 2 weeks ago. You asked, is there going to be anything else coming forward? And we did mention at that time that this was going to be coming on Beatrice Plus at that time. You know, it's definitely not that we were trying to hide this by any means. You know, both these applications were turned in at the same time. You know, we are not trying to, you know, to pull any sort of tricks here. We're just trying to do a public service. Main Street Beatrice is trying to pay...
What are you going to pay out of this, Michael?
25% of the cost of putting in trash cans for this community.
And that's coming out of Main Street?
That's coming out of Main Street Beatrice's budget that's been given to us by different businesses or through our fundraising efforts and whatnot. And it's there to replace trash cans that the city is removing here this summer. You know, that's what we're trying to do here. So we definitely are not trying to pull a fast one on the City of Beatrice. We're trying to work with the City of Beatrice and trying to work with this community to bring a valuable project.
I don't have a problem with the project. I don't have a problem one with the project. It's the way it's going about it. I do not like to be put, this application, put in front of me saying that you guys want $1,125. And then 2 weeks later, you come back and ask for another, double it, $2,250, when it states right there that the other funds will be raised, not city funds. The other funds are to be raised. That's what it says.
And I guess in that case, that was an omission. You know, with turning both those in, I considered Beatrice Plus with the roundup money as something different. So that's a mistake on my part, I guess, in trying to do that. But yeah, definitely is not something that we were trying to at all try to deceive anybody here a couple weeks ago.
I'm voting against it. Just because, next time, just come to me straight up and say, Rich, this is the project. We need $4,500. That's the way I like it. I don't like the games.
Well, people donate that dollar off of their bills, or that whatever, the round off the bills. Richie, they're not designating which project has to be done. It goes into the till to where whatever the different organizations come forward and need the dollars.
I understand how the project works.
Michael's just using what's available out there.
And one other thing here real quick.
Does anybody not understand what I'm saying? It states on this application that the funds will be raised somehow other than city money.
I understand what you're saying, Rich, but he told us 2 weeks ago.
He
told us that he was going to bring this.
And thing. I waited, didn't I? I waited to see if it was going to happen.
I'm a little surprised that you're surprised.
I'm not surprised. Okay. Not surprised at all.
But I think it's a good project, Michael. And David, you're right.
As do I.
This part of your funding. To bring this up, and part of the Beatrice Plus funding for this, and all becomes city property. And so, you know, you have a volunteer organization and people that put in their time and their money to give back to the city in this instance. And I, you know, from my perspective, I wish we would just give them one, make a light item in the budget and be done with it and not have them trot them in here all the time. But that's a different discussion. So. But no, I'm going to vote for it. I think it's a good project. So thanks for bringing it, Michael.
Anybody else?
One real quick thing that was brought up last time we were here was more information on just what exactly Main Street Beatrice is doing, some different data on things. I still need to put together specific data on some of the requests from 2 weeks ago. It's been quite busy, a lot of good things going on. But I do have just some reinvestment statistics, some things that took place last year downtown that I figured I'd share with you. So I'll hand this to you guys before I sit down, that way you have that here with you as well. So.
Alrighty. Thank you, Michael.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, Michael.
Item L, we need to vote for it. Yeah. Call for vote. Alrighty. Michael's passed them out. Shall we go to our vote on item L?
Thank you.
And that passes 7-1.
7-1 with Kerr.
7-1 with Councilman Kerr being naughty and voting no. Okay.
I didn't appreciate that, Mr. Tipperary Mayor.
Richie, we've discussed that.
I'll tell your wife.
Times. Alrighty, moving on to item M. Mr. Party, please.
Make a motion for approval of Beatrice Plus funding request from the Friends of the Homestead in the amount of $5,000 for bus transportation during the eclipse weekend be approved, accepted, or ratified as presented.
Second.
Moved by Party, second by Bob, for the approval of the funding from the Friends of the Homestead. I can't remember who pulled that off. Okay, Teddy.
Once again, don't have a problem with the project. I voted for J. I just can't vote for M. I think that we need to take this out of what would be the lodging tax. I think, as Tobias stated earlier, that fund generates more revenue than what we've put in the budget for that. The remainder goes into the general fund. I just think that we need to take it out of Beatrice Plus and take it from the general fund. I don't think that that's where these dollars should be spent. So I don't have a problem with the project. I think it's something the city should be doing. I just think we should be taking it out of our lodging tax. That's what the lodging tax is designed for. So I'd like to make a motion that I think I have to vote on this before I can make a motion to change that. Can I make the motion to change it to the general fund instead of this?
It's going
to
be, if that is an option, that's your only option, because once we vote on it, it's dead.
So
Okay. I'd like to make a motion that we do not take the $5,000 from the Beatrice Plus, but we take it from the general fund, i.e. the lodging tax.
Okay, we have a motion on the floor by Mr. Fairbanks to move the funding to move it out of the lodging tax. Do we have a second?
Second.
Party did originally.
Party. So we have second.
So now discussion on that motion.
Yeah.
I really don't care where we get out of it. I just want them to have the money.
I
agree with what you're saying.
Okay, but this is the problem. So the Beatrice Plus Fund is a limited amount of revenue on an annual basis. And we have lots of different organizations that come to that and come to and ask for that. And generally what we do, on the Beatrice Plus Fund, we're looking at something that is a capital improvement, one. And two, they have some revenue put into it. Now, they explained to us that they do, that this isn't 100% funding through this. But I just think that the general fund and the lodging tax is a better place for that and leave this fund available for other things. So I don't have a problem with the project. I just want it paid for somewhere else. So.
Question. And how does that affect our finances?
Well, this is.
Does it throw a curve into that or?
Well, if you pass this motion, obviously you're going to take $5,000 out of the general fund that aren't currently budgeted for. Again, we get to the end of the year, as we do most every year. We look at all the revenues and we look at all the expenses and we see how it compared to what we budgeted. Many times we come back and we amend the budget. And that's ultimately what we'll do here in September to account for this $5,000.
And just for everyone's information, we have roughly?
I can't think off the top of my head what we have in the lodging tax fund. Because we have some of that earmarked for a project coming up next year.
Yep.
But if I gave you a number now, I'd be guessing.
But in the general fund, we have a reserve of?
General fund, we have a reserve of $2 million.
There you go.
So we'll still make payroll.
Yeah. My point.
All right, Mark.
I just wanted to clarify from our earlier discussion, when asked about the contracting, it's not the Friends Homestead that's doing the contracting on this. This is actually the National Park Service.
Yep. And you guys are going to need the money.
Okay. Does anybody else would like to speak on the motion that Teddy has brought up? Okay. Your vote on the motion then.
This is the motion to amend the funding source.
Yep. All righty. That passes 8-0. That money will come out of general fund dollars and we'll be in
Merv. We have to vote on the whole thing.
One more vote now.
Now we have to approve the.
Oh, okay. That's right. All
spend
right.
the money.
So is there any other discussion on the actual program itself? If not, there'll be a vote on the motion to approve the $5,000 to Friends of the Homestead.
There we go. Good job. All righty.
Take a vote. Please.
Vote. 8-0. All right.
Petey.
I'm sorry. Yes, sir.
Before you move on to new business, this handout that Michael put out, halfway down,
no, it's
Michael.
It's not on the agenda. We can't talk about it now.
Can't discuss it.
I'll talk to you after the meeting, Michael. Okay. Thank you.
Okay. I'll track which one's next. Okay. We are all done, finally, with the consent agenda.
Move on to the body.
Yeah, you love to. I get confused.
You're doing good,
enough,
David.
About all this.
You're doing good.
I think I'm going to return the favor. Okay. Moving on to our public hearings and / bids. Public hearing will now be held on the new application of GIGJA69 LLC, doing business as Florio's Italian Grill for a Class 1 liquor license. And you've got it. Okay, here we go. We're swearing in Bruce Lang, Chief of Police, and Greg Butcher, our city attorney. Do you swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you God?
I do.
All right.
I do.
You spoke for me. I appreciate that.
I'm going to make sure you do.
Okay.
How about that?
Works for me.
I'll start first. The police department did a standard background investigation for liquor license application, and nothing was uncovered that would preclude us from recommending this to go forward to the Liquor Control Commission. With that, I submit these documents.
On behalf of the City of Beatrice Building Inspections Office, we conducted a liquor application planning report similar to the planning reports we've conducted for liquor licenses at this establishment a number of times before. Nothing out of the ordinary, and so we would also recommend approval of this moving on to the Liquor Control Commission.
All righty. In an earlier discussion, these folks are not with us this evening.
They called and said that they couldn't be here and wanted me to pass that along.
All
right. They got caught out of town or some kind of emergency, so.
All righty. Is there anyone in the audience would speak in either favor or against this liquor license? Okay. Anybody on the council? Anything else? If not, I would entertain that the public hearing be closed.
Make a motion the public hearing be closed at 7:41 p.m.
Second.
You have a motion by Mr. Pardee, second by Bob, that the public hearing be closed at 7:41 p.m. Your vote, please. And that carries 8-0. All right.
Motion by Pardee.
Make a motion to application of GIGJA69 LLC, doing business Florio's Italian Bar and Grill, at 205 North 6th Street, be Suite 18, Beatrice, Nebraska, for a Class 1 liquor license, be recommended to the Nebraska Liquor License Commission for approval.
Second.
Moved by Pardee, second by Bilsbach, that the application of GIGJA69 LLC, doing business at Florio's Italian Grill, 2205 North 6th Street, Suite 18, Beatrice, Nebraska, for a Class 1 liquor license, be recommended to the Nebraska Liquor Control Commission for approval. Discussion. No discussion. We'll move on to your vote, please. And that passes 8-0. All righty. We have no resolutions, no ordinances, and we move on to the public forum. The purpose of the public forum is for the presentation of any item by the general public to the City Council for consideration at a later date. No discussion or action will be taken by the City Council at this time. Does anyone in the audience have anything for the public forum?
There you go.
Yeah.
Yep. Come on up.
Pass glasses around. Cool. You guys grab something if you need something.
Here, Mark, let me help you. If you want to pass stuff out and if you want to talk.
And then last time I was here, I didn't give a lot of information on programs and activities. And anyway, here's a list of our programs as they are right now. I can share with you we are getting a lot. We're getting much support from NASA, and they're sending us many scientists from a number of their different programs. There is a weather balloon that there's going to be launched from the monument from New Mexico State University, as well. Ready, Get, Go, the PBS series, will be here and performing for 2 days with the Ready, Get, Go band. There is a special announcement. Unfortunately, I can't share that information tonight, but be watching in May for a pretty big announcement. So we're excited about it. We think that it'll, I know it'll draw a lot of interest to the community. So, and here's the now, here's the press release the Ready Jet Go program. So.
Here, Mark, you gave me.
Thank you all for your support, and I'll be happy to come back and give you a more detailed report.
Thank you.
Closer.
Thanks.
Thanks, Mark.
Thank you, Mark. All righty. If there's nothing else for the public forum, we move into item 7, discussions and reports. We begin with 7A, Engage Quarterly Report. Good evening,
he's going
sir.
To swear you in too. Walker,
right? He's sworn in?
No.
I don't know.
He might be sworn out.
If the mayor feels like it, yeah.
I get in trouble if I say you're naughty, so I'm not saying that no more.
Nothing.
Alrighty.
All right. be easy on me, I guess. I think everyone's probably got the handout for our strategic plan. I sent it to Aaron here the other day. Kind of working on maybe revising that a little bit to kind of just fit kind of what Glennis and I are working on. We're coming up on a year now. I think we're hitting our groove. I've been meeting with all of our board members one-on-one over the last week, just trying to figure out if we feel like we're heading in the right direction. I think I'm getting some positive news, and I think things all hit on them from our strategic plan for our report from quarter one. I still think we are at a pretty good 2016, and we're kind of cranking on 2017. So we've already done 15 BREs, met with 15 different companies so far in the first quarter, and our goal is 40 for the year, so I think we should be able to hit that one pretty easily. I think we're actually almost there already. We submitted, and something that I think is kind of cool to see is in economic development, we see these kind of pendulum swings of sometimes there are a lot of projects, sometimes there are no projects. And we hadn't seen much from the State Department of Economic Development, even since I'd been down there. I hadn't submitted on a proposal to the state. And we submitted on two projects in quarter one, which I think usually projects go in these swings. When you start to see some, maybe we'll see more, which I think is good. We've had a lot of activity just of the things that Glennis and I have been drumming up. And so now that the state's kind of bringing some things too, that's positive. One of the things we kind of looked at doing was some type of a virtual building, since we have some really good land that you guys own out in the industrial park. Sometimes that doesn't show the best, even though it's a really great piece of land, and now that Hendrick's going to be out there, we have street and all the infrastructure and everything, but a virtual building kind of sets it over the top. And we did something kind of similar for one of these projects we just submitted on, and I think we're trying to take it a step further and market a little bit more. So assuming we don't get that one project, so I guess recruitment, we're tracking over 50 different projects in our system right now, and some of those are recruitment projects, some of them are expansions, some of them are just, you know, so we hear about somebody doing a building remodel or just a business inquiry. We're tracking all of that. We put all of our notes in the system, but we have, I think, close to 60 different projects now that we track daily. As far as a small business, we think we've had a fair amount of activity on that lately. Some folks looking at downtown buildings. Glennis worked with Colleen's when they ended up buying that Radio Shack building. We met with them pretty early, I think, right when I first started here. One of my first meetings, we went over to Radio Shack, and they said, you know, we're thinking about doing something. We had to kind of keep it on the down low for a while, but kind of marketing on the back end. And Colleen ended up falling back into that thing. And I don't know, that's going to be pretty cool, having an event space of 400-some people in downtown on Main Street. So I like to see that there's some interest in Main Street, and there's some other people that are looking at buildings too. As far as workforce, so when we do BREs, one of the biggest issues I think that comes up with our big businesses is they need people. And I don't really think that our issue so much is we need people, because we have an outflow of 2,500 people a day from Gage County that leave the county and go work elsewhere. I think that our issue is probably pay or something else, that they don't want to work here. So we're kind of tackling it in a couple different ways. One, I think just workforce in general, keeping the people that are here, that are going to school. So we've started, we've been working with the Department of Labor, the Department of Education, the Department of Economic Development, Beatrice Public Schools, and some local businesses, our Manufacturing Council. And we officially now kind of have in place a mechanism for high school juniors and seniors to get dual credit. So they can get high school credit and they can go work as an internship at a local business. So they can get paid, they get high school credit, they learn all the skills, and then, you know, they could have a job coming out of high school. So we're kind of eliminating that they're leaving to go somewhere else to work. If we have them all their skills and they can work somewhere here, it's pretty seamless for them to transition into a job. So this is just like really hot off the blocks. We just kind of rolling it out in the last week or so. So I don't know, look for that. And if you hear of any kids or you want to push it to any of the kids, it's I don't know, it's a pretty good avenue to go to school and get paid to go to school. So I feel like it should be a win-win, but we'll see. And then also kind of going to the next thing, but goes back to workforce too, of just kind of marketing. We've been writing some different articles. I just wrote a couple articles. We haven't even rolled them out yet. But they're kind of geared towards that work to the workforce, you know, to those people in appeal, why don't you work where you live? And here's all the money you would save. Here's all the time you would save by not traveling to Lincoln or to Marysville or wherever you're going. And we don't specifically say that, but, you know, it's mileages of, you know, if you drive X amount of miles and you take a job for this much, you could be working here making this much and you're net higher. So it's kind of a couple of different articles of along those lines. And then we also just rolled out another article, too, making just trying to give kind of bringing in the community so people know what we're doing every day. I just wrote an article called Must Be Present to Win. Basically saying, why do we go to trade shows? Why do we go to conferences? Why do we travel the world? Why are we always out and about? Because if you're not there, somebody else is. And so we want people to remember our face. They want to know that we can be easy to call and we're always around. So I think it's just kind of a cool article. That'll be actually in our newsletter, and I think we'll probably click send on the newsletter tomorrow. So I'm just doing some final edits on it. But that one went out, and we also have been pushing around on LinkedIn. So we didn't do a newsletter in Q1. Just because we had so much stuff going on with our annual report, and then also we did that Must Be Present to Win, and we've been kind of floating that around on social media. So hopefully everyone saw it. If you didn't, engagegroup.org, it's on there. What else? We're up to over 40 investors now, which I think is pretty cool. I think it's just exciting to see people giving us their assurance that we're doing the right thing. So having them kind of buy in, it certainly helps us be present to win and get to all these different conferences and things. And then just kind of other things, we're trying to stay up to date on legislation. There are a lot of different TIF bills, and there are a lot of workforce bills, housing bills, just the budget in general is crazy. We've expressed our concerns, I guess, to state and federal legislators about the importance of historic tax credits, affordable housing tax credits, just everything we can. We want to make sure that none of those funding sources get cut. I don't know. That's about it. I guess Glennis got an award in quarter one from REAP, the Rural Enterprise Assistance Project. She was named Friend of the Year, which was pretty cool. We went to her awards banquet in New York like a month or so ago. So it's kind of cool to be recognized on a state level for the things that we're doing and the things that she's doing and the projects that she has brought them. People notice. So kind of going back to the be present to win, the more things we're involved in, the more things people notice and the more our name's out there and about. And, oh, and then if everybody hasn't used a little library yet, I would encourage that. I am part of leadership class 11, and that was our brainchild, was to bring little libraries around the city. I think Beatrice Plus Funds even maybe helped with some of those. But yeah, they're pretty cool, the amount of support that we've gotten and the recognition and the use. We had our kickoff last week, and it was awesome. I think it's doing what it's supposed to do, and it's getting kids reading, it's getting families reading, it's getting people out and using parks and being out about, and I don't know, it's pretty exciting. We've already had one pop up that we didn't even know was coming. It just popped up on a tree the other day too, so there are more in the works. Questions?
All righty. Does anybody have any questions for Walker?
Rich.
Walker, your retail,
mm-hmm.
Glennis is in charge of that? You in charge
like
of
study?
That? How many new businesses have you brought in the last year to fill the storefronts downtown?
I could look on our annual report. Michael might even know, too.
Well, Michael said there's 13.
I think that's exactly.
Yeah,
I think that.
Year,
I want to say that was what our answer.
I'd like a list of those.
Yeah, I can get you a list. Okay. Have them right here tonight.
Yeah.
That's fine.
Yeah. But we're also working in partnership with Michael on doing a potential study, a retail study, saying, we know we want more businesses downtown, but what do we go after? We need to make the call, but I think it needs to be a targeted, focused call of this is the case why you need to do your business here. So, if it's hardware store, if it's a clothing store, if it's a knick-knack tchotchke store, who knows? But, you know, are people going out to Homestead, or are they people going to...
I'll take anything to fill those storefronts.
You know, but we want to make sure that people succeed. And so we don't want just anything. We want them to, you know, that we can make a case why here's the traffic, here are our numbers, here are what people are doing. This is why we're asking you, and this is why we think you should spend your money here.
But I'm spending a lot of money on three organizations, and I haven't seen what I want to see.
I not to open a can of worms, but it wouldn't mind arguing that, I guess.
Do what?
I don't know. I would imagine, I feel like, I'm grateful you approved our budget, I think we're addressing these.
I don't see any storefronts being filled.
We've definitely had a lot of it.
I want a list of 13. If you would, please.
I'll maybe just go back, just defend what economic development is, what Main Street is, what the Chamber is. I think we're all three separate organizations. In economic development, we're focused on primary jobs. Manufacturing, businesses, office. I think, if you're looking at what have we done to do, I feel like an $8 million turkey hatchery with 25 or 30 people is a pretty significant measurement, but...
And I don't agree with you. Do not agree with you. You're absolutely correct, but that's the industrial end of it. I'm talking about the retail end of it.
Yeah. We're focusing on it. It's not something that happens overnight, but I can't say it's something we're not looking at either.
Well, as I said last week, the three biggest storefronts we've got in town have been empty and been empty for a long time. We need to move. We need to increase our, and that includes the council and everybody else, the city. We need to increase our focus on getting businesses into this town. It's dying, and I don't want to see it die.
On just one aspect with that, that's one thing about this retail study is those larger retail spaces, there's no doubt those are the hardest ones to fill because retail is not the same as it was in the past. I think we all understand that. And so a lot of the trend is definitely a lot more smaller mom-and-pop type businesses, not necessarily the chains like JCPenney's and whatnot. And so, yes, it's part of that retail part that we're wanting to do, that plan to try to do recruitment and do some data analysis, is to figure out what sort of mix. We're already working with a couple property owners with some of those bigger ones to try to come up with some plans that may end up being able to help work on that. And yes, there's definitely some things that are in the works, but it's hard to say that our downtown is at that point because we do have 167 small businesses that are in downtown the last time I counted. And that's a significant chunk of small businesses in this community. And there's no doubt it's not where we want it, as we talked 2 weeks ago. We want to see it go a lot better. We're right there with you. We want to be doing a lot more to help out with this, just like Engage in the Chamber. So,
certainly hope so, because I'm going to keep harping on it. I'm going to keep harping on it.
Okay. Teddy?
Hey, Walker. And you addressed it in part of the report, talked about housing studies.
Yeah.
And we talked about the housing development you're having. So when you talk to them on a state level, and you talk to these people about these things on a federal level, on a national level, the problem that we have as a city entity here, one of the problems that we have, is we don't have the money to take down the dilapidated structures that we have. So I guess I'm just kind of trying to nudge that part. I've called my state senator, I've called my congressman, and I've done that. But we need to have that revenue to take down the dilapidated structure so those lots are available.
You're talking about just single-family residences?
Well, not even that. If we
old
purchased,
hospitals or...
Yeah, well, like we... Well, the hospital thing we got taken care of. That was kind of... That was, we... Nice to be able to work with the hospital foundation, the hospital itself, but, we purchased the old Allen Peace grain elevator across from the old Dempster's thing. That's going to be... But, and if you drive through... the city, we have houses that are dilapidated that we'd like to be able to take down to be able to bring those neighborhoods back up a little bit, also provide that lot for something that's truly buildable. Because so that's my little nudge to you, that if somewhere along the line in those talking points, if that funding mechanism, that's important to communities our size. So
no, and I think that's a good point. So we were at the NYFA housing conference a couple weeks ago, and there was somebody that's actually the administrator from Central City, and they knew it was a huge issue too, and they essentially just ended up making a list. They line itemed in their budget, and they said, we're putting this much money here. They made a hit list of houses, and they said, if this comes available, here's our dollar sign, and we will buy that as soon as we can, and they're going to take it down.
Yeah.
And so, and for most of the cities I've seen that have done that have just line itemed it and said, it's going to be over the next 3 or 4 years.
I've had that conversation with our, but I don't think us, it's a struggle.
Yeah.
So, well, and the other thing.
I'm just asking you to put that in the, as a talking point. We need those revenues.
Yeah. The thing is, a lot of these developers, too, just economies of scale, they want to get an empty piece of ground where they can go bing, 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 and get them all nailed. It is. Yeah. Sometimes, but then infrastructure, you got to put all that in, which you can argue that maybe it isn't as cheap.
Well, they don't generally pay for that. We generally do for that. You know, we if somebody comes in and says we're going to do X number of houses, we'll pay for that. So, yeah, they don't. But, well, we all pay for it a bit. Anyway, just a talking point. That's all. But the rest of it, I have no problem with. Thank you.
No. But as far as housing goes, I didn't really address that, but we have a ton of irons in the fire on that right now, and really good ones. My in-laws were in town the other day, and I gave them a tour, and it actually was, I hadn't even realized how many different projects we, I mean, we circled the entire city, and you start to, from Flowing Springs all the way to stuff that's going on north of town, and there's stuff going up on the west side, there's stuff, we have a couple different things going on the east side. It's awesome.
All righty. Bob.
That's what I was saying. I think, you know, I really think from an end gauge perspective, 2016 was a good year. We had a lot of things going. I think that you'll see some things continue to go. You know, Rich, I think you still have, I mean, downtown is always going to be a struggle. I think, you know, when you look at retail, it's going to change dramatically because of what the internet has done with online shopping. So they're going to have to look at maybe different niches to fill those places because retail across the country has had a dramatic drop off. You know, when you can go to 10 or 15 sites and buy everything you want that they give you free shipping on, it's a tough go. And so I think there's opportunities, but I think you're right. I think, you know, I know Glennis and I know that Walker are working hard to try to figure those out as well as Michael, but it is going to be a tough nut to crack that we're going to have to stay on top of.
That was my point. I'm going to stay on it.
All righty. Does anybody else have anything else for Walker? All right, thank you, Walker. Great report.
You're welcome.
Thank you. All righty, moving on to item 7B, City Administrator's Month of the Report. Toby.
Again, if you guys have any questions, a couple of highlights. Obviously, today, 6th and Industrial Road, that project started. So you'll saw a lot of barricades go up out there, and that project got underway. The gas plant cleanup continues down there. The remedial action plan has been amended, and that has been submitted to NDEQ for their review. That essentially is the guidelines that we have to follow to clean up that site down there. The amendment has to do with the area that is west of where we're currently working, that underneath the railroad tracks. There is some push for us to remove those railroad tracks, solidify that ground there, and then put the railroad tracks back. All that would have to be done in accommodation with the co-op and their time frame, which is about July 1st is a drop dead date for them. So they make sure trains roll in for harvest time. So a project that has moved very slowly for a decade has to move very quickly, and so we'll see how that works. We have to get several different state and federal agencies to sign off on it, so it might not happen. We'll see. But if it doesn't, it'll simply occur at a future time, maybe next year. Many of you have probably seen Highway 77, the curb ramps being done. That's the Department of Roads project. City of Beatrice has nothing to do with that project. We didn't pick those curb ramps. We didn't pick the design. The contractor showed up one day, started working, and we were as surprised as everybody else. So that project should be wrapping up fairly soon. They're in one spot pretty quickly and then off to the next one. So they're making quick work, but that's not our project. This next week, you have two bid openings. You have the piggyback. That bid opening is on Wednesday. And so you'll have a BASWA meeting next Monday night to approve that bid and hopefully get that contractor started in May yet. And the other bid opening is for Ridgeview Drive. That's the extension of the road that goes currently to Precise Fabrication. It'll extend out to the Turkey Hatchery, take a right-hand turn, and it'll become Tegmeyer Lane there. So that extension is out for bid on Thursday is when that one is due. So
definitely a busy season coming up. Richard?
It is a busy season. The industrial road project. How long is that going to be shut down, Toby?
That contract is let for about 45 to 60 days.
A couple of months.
Okay. It should be a fairly quick project, but 45 to 60 days is what the contract calls for.
Yeah, somebody called me just wanted to know, and I didn't know when how long it was going to take, so a couple of months.
First part of June, it should be open back up.
Good.
You what?
I had a question for the attorney. I'm sure we'll get a report later on about the city cleanup, how it went. It looks like it went real well. What about the items that are still left? I seen there's a mattress on Market, and there's some couches on West Court and some other items.
I believe Chet.
Are we going to ticket some people, or have we done that already?
I think Chet hit everybody, what do you say, north of?
I'll say north of Lincoln.
The other day, and I think he's hitting south of Lincoln.
Probably, he's probably back in tomorrow. So tomorrow he'll go back around. I would just say if you see any items out in the public, especially mattresses, piles of items that may not have been picked up, sanitary garbage did a good job of following up and picking things up while they're out there. I thought it looked better than other years that we had seen. But if you see something out there, go ahead and call into code enforcement, report it, and we'll be able to tell immediately whether it's already on the list because we have that computer system now. And if we don't have it on the list, we'll add it to it, and Chet will get it checked out tomorrow.
228-5250.
The two I called in were already on the list.
Really?
Yep.
So if you're out there and you see something, that's the phone number to call, 228-5252 or 50. So give them a call, and they'll go out and track it down.
And don't assume somebody else called it in. If you see it, call it in. That's how we get it cleaned up quick.
Any other questions? As if not, if you have somebody, just feel free to give me email, text me, whatever works, and we'll get an answer for you.
Didn't move on.
All righty. If there's nothing else for the regular meeting, this time we're going to go into executive session. There's no action tonight. We'll be taking no Doug or any.
No action.
No action will be taken, so.
Make a motion, Beatrice City Council, go into closed session at 8:06 p.m. for the protection of public interest to discuss contract negotiations.
Second. Moved by party. Or the motion has been moved by party, second by Joey, that the Beatrice City Council go into closed session at 8:10 p.m. for the protection of public interest to discuss contract negotiations. Your vote, please.
And that carries. I'm sorry. No, I guess I didn't.
Not you. 7-1, it passes. Bill Block voted no.
7-1. Okay, we are in executive session.